Okay, it's 9:00. We'll call the meeting to order with a moment of silence. Thank you. First order of business is to approve the agenda.
Motion to approve the agenda.
Support.
Motion made and seconded to approve the agenda. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Approve the minutes of March 21.
Is approved.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to approve the minutes of March 21. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. We have March bills to approve.
Make the motion to approve the bills for March.
Support.
Motion made and seconded to approve paying March bills. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. We have to accept the final fiscal year 2015 Mahaska County audit.
We've all had a chance to review it. Just need to accept it.
Move to accept audit.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to accept the audit of fiscal year 15 for Mahaska County. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. We have a third quarter report from the auditor.
I emailed that to you also.
Motion to approve.
Support.
Motion made and seconded to approve the third quarter report from the auditor. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. We have two payroll changes, one from the sheriff to remove Sharon Oshinger on effective date of 3/24.
I'll make the motion to remove Sharon, excuse me, Oshinger from the payroll effective March 24.
Support.
Motion made and seconded to remove Sharon from the sheriff's payroll effective 3/24. All in favor, say aye.
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 Motion carried. We have one from secondary roads to remove Scott Skippers effective March 25th.
Move to accept the resignation of Scott Skippers effective March 25th.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to accept Scott's resignation. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Approve voting system security policy update. This comes from Sue Brown.
I emailed it to you. It's just an update of the policy since we have new voting equipment. Puts that in there. Everything else is basically the same.
Make a motion that we approve the security policy update for voting system.
Support.
Motion made and seconded to approve the voting system security policy update. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried. You want us to sign that now or later, or what do you want to do?
Do it later.
Okay. All right. Dakota Access Pipeline updates. Nobody hear from them right now?
I don't see them, no.
Okay. We'll come back to that. Jamie, countywide communication project.
Morning, gentlemen.
Morning.
So some time ago, you guys, we put together a committee to look at the possibility of hiring someone to come in and evaluate our countywide communications. The committee met several times, actually. We received a total of 7 or 8 bids. We looked at all those. We called references. And the committee would like to make a recommendation to do a contract with Ellert and Associates out of Minnesota. Hopefully, you guys have had a little chance to review that material.
The numbers on there, the recommendation is it's phase one, phase two. Is that updates or is that studying?
So phase one is just the one that we're at right now, which that would be the 23,000. Basically, what that is they would come in, look at countywide communication systems, and then basically develop what we need as a county to move forward with long-term communication goals. So, you know, the state's looking at a 700 megahertz system, and I believe you sat in on some of those meetings. Mm-hmm. But is that what's best for Mahaska County? And that's what we need to know. Because the 700 system, though it's a strong system, there's a huge price tag with it. And if we can get by with long-term VHF P25 like other counties are doing, you know, that'd be a better direction for us. We just need to know what is the solution to our communication? You know, we have a lot of gaps with our radios and pagers and stuff like that. So this would be someone from the outside coming in, looking at the structure of our county and kind of giving us an idea of where we need to go. So we can get our system so up and running.
The phases and the numbers that you have there are all, those are consulting fees?
Yes. So, this first one would be $23,400 to come in and look at that and recommend something. And then moving forward down the road, when I set up the RFQ, I wanted multi-phases because I just don't want someone to come in and say, here, this is what we're looking at just for this one piece. And then, you know, redo this all over again, and this is now what we're looking for. So it was kind of give us an idea, looking long term, you know, what's this project going to cost? Now remember, this doesn't include acquisition, purchase of radios or pagers or anything like that. This is just to get the network built for this county.
Right. It's just consulting fees.
Yes.
Did you receive any other bids or? When you sent out your RFQ, was this the only proposal? That
No, we had seven of them. We reviewed.
That's one that you
And initially, we talked about Mazzatello. And then we got to checking references and stuff, and Alert really came back very high. Matter of fact, some of the references we checked for the Mazzatello actually recommended the Alert. So it sounds like they have a very strong voice for the person that they contract with. There was a couple things, and I'll just throw this out as an example. There was some grounding cable, which is buried very deeply. And the way it was done, the contractor had come in and did it, and it wasn't done the way it was supposed to. And, you know, they went to bat, made them dig it all back up and completely redo it all. You know, and that's good because us looking at it would think, oh yeah, it's done right, that's fine. And move forward, then have problems with it 5 years down the road. While they were checking on all this stuff, we thought that was there were some really good comments about this company. So they are used by multiple counties within the state of Iowa. So
yeah, on that one there. Resume, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So you need for us to approve the
So basically, it would be approved to contract with them at the $23,400. Yep.
Okay. I'll make the motion.
Support. I think it's, we try to vet them, or at least you guys gathered a lot of information as to who's going to do the best job, and taking that into account and costs into account, this was the kind of the recommendation of the entire group, and so I think they'll do a good job, and they have a pretty good reputation and sort of putting together the information, and I'm confident they'll reach out, you know, countywide to all the different fire departments and up in New Sharon and down by Cedar and work with everybody here in town and figure out what we need to get, but I think it'll be good. So, that's why I support the motion.
Okay, so the recommendation, the motion is to select Ellert and Associates of Stillwater, Minnesota for phase one for $23,400. Correct? Okay. All in favor of this, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
I'll just get with Sue and I'll get with Ellert and we'll get the contract taken care of. Thank you.
All right. Heather?
Good morning.
Morning.
Wanted to give you a little bit of an update. As you're all aware, Managed Care has come to Iowa, started on Friday. In the process of that, Mahaska County Case Management has been working on contracts with all three of the managed care. Our primary one is AmeriHealth. Our 86 clients have chosen AmeriHealth as their managed care. In the process of going through all that, about 2 weeks ago, I received a business agreement addendum from AmeriHealth asking for some things that were not in their original business agreement, things talking about HIPAA compliance, encryption, what our liability insurance entailed. So I've been working with a couple of different committees, the HIPAA committee, our IT person, our county attorney, to make sure we're all in place. I was hoping today to have a revised business agreement addendum for you guys to all read and sign. I don't, because we don't quite have all the moving pieces together.
But what I would like to do is, once I have all of those pieces together, send that to you all in the email, and have you guys give Willie permission to then sign it. I think what will happen is everything's going to come together probably pretty quick this week, and I really don't want to wait until the next board meeting to have approval, simply because right now we're in a transition period. AmeriHealth has been very accommodating with us getting all these pieces together, but I don't want to delay things unnecessarily should all the pieces come together this week. Do you have any questions?
No, I'm just trying to figure out how to do what you're asking without being an open meeting.
Right.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we can.
I don't either. That's why I'm asking.
Yeah.
So probably not.
Is there a timeline on it? Is there a deadline on it?
Yesterday.
Oh.
Ideally, everything would have been in play by April 1, but AmeriHealth didn't get the contract to us or the addendum until the end of March. And we've been snagged up on a couple of things beyond our control that we're working through. Like I said, AmeriHealth hasn't demanded the agreement, but they would like it sooner rather than later. And I anticipate some pieces coming together pretty quick this week to get everything done. We've made significant movement already in meeting the requirements for the addendum, such as they originally wanted a one-day. When it comes to HIPAA, if we had a violation, for instance, with our PHI information, they had originally wanted a one-day turnaround. I've negotiated them to 3. They wanted a paper report within 5 days. I've negotiated them to 15 to give us time to put that stuff together. I know Darren, our IT person, has had a couple of meetings with encryption systems, and hopefully we'll have something in play by the end of the week. We do have a recommendations by the HIPAA committee on today's agenda to move that forward. We're waiting on the, I forget what you called it, Sue, from the liability insurance people.
Insurance certificate.
Telling us, outlining what our, what we have as a county to make sure we're covered in that regard, so.
Well, then when you get this together later in the week.
Can I ask for an open meeting?
If that's
coming back on Monday.
Yeah, we're gonna have to get together again on Monday.
Okay.
Anyway, so
just kind of keep you all in the loop, and if I get everything put together this week, ask for the open meeting on Monday.
We can just add it to our agenda.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
We already have one.
Okay. All right. Does have any questions about that? I will tell you that we also have a business agreement. I got it on Friday from AmeriGroup. I've printed it. That's as far as I've gotten. We will work through that one, too, when I get the AmeriHealth one done. And the reason we'll do the AmeriGroup one also is because they have talked about, at a 4-month, so about July, they're going to reassess what it looks like for managed care from their perspective, case management, and whether or not they want to continue to either move forward in taking case management internally or contract. We don't have anybody currently on our caseload that has AmeriGroup, but should they decide to contract with us, having that agreement will allow us then to take on referrals for people who would choose to have AmeriGroup as their managed care. So we're just trying to position ourselves to help the people in Mahaska County to the best of our ability.
We don't have anybody currently in Mahaska County with them?
Not that we case manage.
Okay.
So that's something that could change in the future, and we want to be ready to provide that assistance. So, you want me to stay up here for the HIPAA one, too?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
We have a proposal from Across Compliance Solutions to, I guess, go through our primarily Heather's
PHI information.
All of her information to ensure we're HIPAA compliant and all this stuff, and working with Darren and getting some things in place. And this company does work with the region.
Mm-hmm. And Iowa Association of Counties, they're contracting with them also.
I know the county attorney says he is not in a position to do this. You know what I'm saying?
HIPAA rules are, for that state of Iowa, are more in-depth than federal rules are. And they change fairly often, and to stay on top of it, I don't think, in my opinion, the county is in a really good position to have somebody take that on as part of their job description. And so that's why I think we started having a conversation about an external specialist.
This would be only for 1 year. This would be a 1 year agreement right now to see how this all goes, how this plays out, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got successive years on there, but that's.
We can take it 1 year at a time.
We're going to take this first year, and that's what the committee had recommended.
Mm-hmm.
Sue, Jim Bongren, Darren, and Heather and I have met with this gentleman, this Roger, a couple of times, and there's not a lot of other HIPAA stuff, but they will look at the other offices, everything else kind of combined while they're doing their analysis of everything. So,
the original proposal was for a comprehensive analysis for all departments,
mm-hmm.
and now he's going to focus on case management and. The Mahaska building over there.
That's where your biggest liability is at, I guess.
That's what he'll prioritize. He'll come in and do a physical walkthrough of all of the county, and then he'll prioritize my office because of the PHI information we have, along with making sure we're in compliance with the managed care requirements. So,
is it the same cost? Is he going to charge the same? Whether he's just doing one or whether he's doing the whole thing,
Well, that's yeah, because we could separate that out, but I think committee felt the first year we should look at the whole thing and then go from there. That's would make sense to me.
I think because we share, it's not so much that I share protected health information necessarily with other parts of the county. It's just that because we work in the same system. It's to our best advantage to have him check to make sure we're good to go. And then on the off chance, which hopefully this would never happen to us, but we have friends to the south that this has happened, where their PHI information has been kidnapped, held hostage, whatever, he would then help us go through the process of getting that information back without it being an additional cost to the county. And depending on the situation, if we felt like we needed to sue that entity or whatever, that I think that's part of that. But it's more because we're so moving in a technology-based paperless society that we're at risk to having our stuff hacked. So. I think the recommendation from the HIPAA committee is to hire him.
I guess I don't have a problem with it for 1 year. I don't want to lock into future years. They have it listed at $8,000 for successive year, but if we do it one time and figure out what our vulnerabilities are, I think that would be better. So.
And they'll let us know. I mean, of course, we'll keep track of when our contract is up, but they'll also talk to us about 9 months in to see what if we want to continue, what our needs are, that kind of thing. He's already worked with me a little bit with the MCO stuff to make sure we're in compliance there. So
did he, and the number that he came up with for what it's going to cost, did he give you any idea of how many hours that is? What, I mean, is that an arbitrary number? Where does he come up with his figures?
He basically took an average of what he's done for other counties, and that's their what they come in. Some counties require more, some counties require less.
Mm-hmm.
So that was his average cost. He did say that they're opening an office in Iowa City, so that's where they'll send their person from, and he'll waive. About travel stuff. They're not going to charge us for that. So
it's kind of like this. Communication thing you just approved. Mm-hmm. Some of it is actual hours, some of it is expertise, and that's, yeah.
Yeah.
before signing an ongoing agreement, I mean, before next year, I'd like to have an hourly breakdown. I really wanted to have it for today, but if he's going to be here, I think that we should be paying on an hourly basis with maybe a cap, and,
We discussed that with him also, and it was, that was kind of, part of it's their expertise, part of it is because they've done this, they know what they're doing, so, and part of it is actual time here. That's.
I don't have a problem with approving the first year.
Move to approve the 1-year agreement with Carouche Compliance Solutions.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to approve this agreement. I guess we could put a number with that. $13,750 with Carouche. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. We have a second reading of ordinance 24, which is a speed limit, which runs west of KBOE to the intersection and then north down, what is that, Lincoln, to the stop sign, I would assume to the highway to the stop sign. We had first reading last meeting, so need a motion to open public hearing. Do we have to public hearing again? Second reading.
This is your second.
Okay.
I'll make the motion that we approve the second reading of ordinance 24.
Support.
Motion made and seconded to support the second reading. In favor, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed.
I haven't received any feedback on, or at least negative feedback on the ordinance. Do you want to waive the third hearing?
I would waive the third reading. I did have one guy kind of poked at me for 25 mile an hour, but I said, well, if you leave enough chuck holes in the road, they won't go over 25 anyway. So, but you made that motion to waive third reading?
Yeah.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to waive third reading. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Set a hearing date for ordinance number 25, policy for roadway and bridge construction.
The reason for this request for change in ordinance is to deal with the Federal Emergency Management Agency. They now insist that if we replace a bridge, we have to explain why we're replacing it with a certain size and type, and same thing with roadways if they're destroyed. They no longer say we use the state DOT's design information and base sheets and what have you. So all the counties are going through this procedure where they are adopting a design resolution and construction ordinance so that if we lose structures due to disasters caused by flooding and whatever, that we would be able to go in there and put in a bridge that would meet what our current needs are for today.
Okay, so do we have a date in mind?
When do you need to have it published, and when could we first do it?
No more than 20, no less than 4.
Do it for the first meeting in May?
Okay.
Or is that too soon?
No.
Too much going on?
It's okay.
We can do it later. I don't care.
It's okay. May 2nd?
May 2nd, if we can make that work.
Actually.
Is that a motion?
Sure.
Do we need a motion on that?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to set the hearing date for ordinance 25 on roadway and bridge construction for May 2nd. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Do we have to have a time?
9.
Assume it's going to be 9 o'clock?
9 o'clock. You want it first thing or you want it later? Dave, does it make any difference?
Doesn't make any difference.
Let's just do it first thing. Now we have authorized signature on Hall Road Damages Agreement. Came through last week.
I just gotten an email late Friday from the oil company, and they are requesting that we add, or they want us to look at additional information. So what I brought was, it just has several points on there, and they wanted to know if we could look at that and with the other counties and see what we want, or if we want to change those points. There's 3 or 4 points that they were having a question on as to an amount of time that would be allowed to, after post-inspection, to complete the repairs. One was on the amount that we're gonna charge for permits, or for administering the permit. The other one was for the amount of surety bond that we would require to make sure that they do indeed repair any haul roads that they damaged during the time of construction. And so they are asking if we could hold off on it. Also, Mr. Duvall from ISG is not going to be able here because there are still some things that they are getting agreed to as to the charges and what are allowed to be charged for and so on and so forth. So he would not be able to be here. He also had asked to be here when that would be signed and stuff. So it, at this time, I would like to leave this copy of the changes that they have. I've already sent a copy to the auditor and the county attorney to look at that and address it, see if they have any concerns. And that I would like to resubmit it at the next board meeting that we have.
Okay. Sounds all right. Anything else? Okay. We have a easement agreement request. Comes from Lyle Nunnicoven and Sharon Nunnicoven. Seems they use, they go through the county farm to get a piece of property. They farm on the backside because they used to have access and don't because of a bridge. I don't know exactly what all that involves, but since that was coming up for sale, they had sent us this wanting to know, I guess they want our approval of this easement before the farm sells, but I don't know. I really don't know if I talked to Jim a little bit about it, and he's, well, they've been doing it for years. It just kind of falls under the old practices, but I talked a little bit to Scott. They're gracious enough to let him go through. They go through to get there. It's not just a path along the fence. They have to go through some planted crops to get there, and I thought if it was a path along a fence is one thing, but when you're going through some guy's crops to get there, I'm hesitant to agree to this, I guess. I just offhand, I don't know what you guys think. I just, the little information I had about it, I just talked to Scott a little bit ago, and that's...
I talked to Lyle, and I sent an email up to Jim, and Jim had talked to Lyle, and Lyle got with his attorney and said, have him draft it and send it, and said at short notice it can be done. But if that's been the common practice for the last, I don't know, however many, he said about 20 or 30 years it's been that way. And the county's worked with him on it. I guess I don't want to cut off access to his, for him getting to his place if there's no other way to get through there.
Yeah, and they probably have some sort of common law easement anyway, being that's the only way they have access, and so it's probably implied that, I mean, they have to get to the ground, and our sale shouldn't really change that, so. How big a parcel is it? Do you know?
Well,
what are they trying to get?
15 acres, something, Scott, or not?
It's only 15 or 20. And yeah. They take a lane back to the west side of the farm, and they probably cross a field that's about 20 acres in size, but they have to probably cover, I don't know, 700-800 feet of through crops to get there. Probably a concern, I would think, to potential buyers if this wasn't maybe out there ahead of their bid would be that you should think about.
Well, it's you guys' pleasure.
Kind of see it that way. Thinking about that, people who have submitted their bids and not knowing that, Lyle and got word that we were selling the county farm and wanted to make sure that he had, had access to it. If there's already a common law one in place, I guess, I don't know that. I don't know what this does to change it. I guess I'm not an attorney, so.
Yeah.
Well, defer to Mike on that.
No, I haven't really looked through it, and it probably needs to be, Jim needs to, we need to get an opinion from him, I'm thinking. I mean, the only, I mean, they're going to have access one way or the other. Either we approve this or they're, I assume they have really no other route to get there. That they've been doing this for some time.
Yeah.
So I don't know if we allow bidders to pull their bid or make them aware of it when we auction, but I mean, yeah, we didn't advertise it as part of this.
No,
subject
didn't.
To this agrees or easement.
Because I wasn't even aware of it, I guess.
Well, I wasn't either.
So. Yeah, what a little bit I talked to Jim was that it's, well, it's been that way a long time. It's kind of hard. It's like you say, it's common law, whatever it is. But that may be something that has to be worked out.
Yeah. But yeah, I think we have to give bidders the opportunity to pull their bid because they weren't aware of it and see if they want to go forward.
Okay. I'll make the motion that we table it, at least so we have to talk about it at the next meeting, pending advisement from Jim.
Support.
Motion made and supported to table the request for easement. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed.
Another, while we're kind of on the topic here, somebody asked me if we're going to guarantee the last payment because it's, somebody could walk away. Not that anybody would because I think we trust who rents it, but they didn't know if we were going to guarantee that last payment or not.
Well, I haven't.
If we don't, I just, would, I said I'd bring it up.
I would think we would. I guess that's between them and Scott, but whoever buys it, but Scott, and they've been very faithful. I'm not too worried about Scott leaving town.
No, I'm not either, but
we did have that happen once, so it's a possibility, but.
That's fine. We can go forward without guaranteeing it. And
yeah.
How do you guys read that, how it's going to split out the last payment? Will it just be the last payment that's made based off of,
well,
date of ownership, or is it going to be prorated? Or?
No, we got the first payment, and the buyer will get the second payment. That's the way it was set up, I believe.
Yeah, I guess I wasn't under that understanding, because I thought since they were buying it starting the beginning of the crop year, they'd get the full crop year payment, but I guess that's, I missed that one.
Oh, I don't know. I thought that's...
So,
like...
What did the notice say?
Find it.
I think the most equitable way would be to prorate it out over a 12-month period, divided by however months that we have it, however months, many months that the new owner owns it, and pay on a monthly basis.
Well, they're going to have it for the full year because we have to close this by June 1, and so we're talking about all of next year anyway, even though the first, I mean, crop year.
The lease, including any payments due from the tenant, shall be assigned to the purchaser from the date of purchase. Parcel one, real estate taxes shall be prorated, etc. So,
it makes it sound like it's going to be prorated.
No, it doesn't. The taxes are prorated. The way I thought it was written is any, and the way Jim said it, what is any future payments that are outstanding are assigned to the buyer.
Where is that? Is that in here? Maybe you guys know what it is.
Well, I think sure. That's it, what you just read.
Yeah, I think okay, that, I think that's
it,
all there
it
is.
Read
that's,
differently it's, than that.
So it'll be assigned to purchaser from date of purchase, so. Is that next week, or is that when it closes?
I think when it closes.
Okay.
Do we already have first payment? Yeah, we already got the first one, so. We're talking about the second payment here, and so anything future is whoever buys it.
Okay.
And taxes are prorated, but it's going to be exempt for a little while till it catches up anyway, yeah. So.
Their taxes will start from the day it closes.
Yeah, but it's this tax year, it's.
So there's nothing.
Owned by us, so yep. It's nothing, so it won't be really assessed for taxes for down the road, as far as I know, but.
Okay. Next one is open bids for purchase of county farm property. Giving that to me. We'll take them from the top. If I can get my, there you go. I got one. I couldn't make it go. Parcel one. This is an offer to purchase real estate. $3,878 per acre for 314 acres from Leroy Grunendike and Dan Nusma and Brandon Grunendike. You want to see that? I don't know. Let's try to stay with one if we can. Okay, we have a bid from Lyle Nunnicoven, parcel one, 314 acres, $3,200 an acre. Scott and Sandra Van Veldhuizen for $2,400 an acre. And is that what that was? Right. Yeah, that goes in that one. That's parcel two. Let's stick with it. See what this one is. It doesn't say if this is a one or a two. Total purchase price of $502,400 from Wardheisen. Keith and Julie Van Wardheisen for 314 acres. Back that back out, however that is. That one goes.
That's
with
the bulk parcels?
Pardon me?
Two parcels. That's
bulk. One parcel.
So that's one parcel.
Yep. Parcel two.
It's on Phillips.
Crystal Phillips and Steve Phillips for $100. We also have another bid on parcel two. bid from Leroy Gernadyke for $500 on the parcel two. And so we have four and two, would that be correct? Next. These people will be contacted and next Monday, is that when we're doing this? The 11th?
Yes.
What time?
10 o'clock.
10 o'clock next Monday morning, we'll convene here and people will be given the opportunity to raise their bids.
How are we giving them notice?
Does it have to be written or can we make phone calls? Ask Jim?
I think we can make phone calls.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've done four.
Okay.
And then somebody had asked the order in which we're going to bid, if we're going to do the tillable first. Did anybody bid on the tillable and parcel one?
No, there's a separate one. There's a separate one for Gernadyke's.
That's right. So I think they had asked if we do the tillable first so that people know who gets that because it may affect how they want to bid parcel one. I don't know if that would be right.
I don't know. If the parcel two is, I think it'll take care. I don't know, putting together.
No, I'm not saying putting together. Okay. I'm saying.
You want to do two first or one first?
Do parcel one first, do the tillable acreage first.
Okay.
And that way people know who has it, which will impact.
They have that option. Okay.
What they may want to do with parcel two.
I can.
So.
Okay.
Do they need to be two separate agenda items then?
Yeah, they still need to be separate, but it's just the order in which we do.
The order.
But I mean, on the agenda.
Yeah, they probably do because there's, I mean, we're. Parcel
one will be done first and then parcel two.
Okay.
So how are we going to do the bidding process and who's going to, are you overseeing that or?
Me or Jim.
Okay.
We will.
And then I assume the top bidder, he's going to be allowed to withdraw his bid because we're going to indicate at the meeting that it's subject to that easement or possibly subject to that easement.
We're going to have to bring that out. Yeah. We're going to have to be aware of it.
And there's a cemetery easement there too?
That's there along that road. That's not a problem, I don't think. It's right along the road that goes back there.
And I don't know where we're gonna close this too. I don't know if we're gonna need to mow but before it closes. Do we need to contract somebody to do that? Let's put that, put it on agenda.
For Monday?
I guess.
Okay.
It depends when it closes, I guess. But it's not going to close till June 1st. We'll need to figure something out.
Anything else? So last item, any public comments? Any motion to adjourn?
You got one coming? Beth's coming.
Oh, yes. Oh, I thought you were leaving. I'm sorry.
I am sorry. I have a very short one. That's okay.
I apologize to you.
That's okay. My name's Beth Danowski. I'm a part of the Mahaska Community Development Group. I'm part of the Kids Corner Board. I'm also part of One Mahaska. And I just want to make a really short statement to the board and also just a statement for the good of the public who view these meetings. As you know, the local option sales tax ballot is coming up in about a month, and as we approach that, people get very interested and have a lot of questions about the project. So offer is if you have people who are asking you questions and want information about the projects, I'm happy to share information with people. They can call the chamber office or they can get on the onemahaska.com site. There's information about the ballots and they can also ask a question. So just in the interest of getting people informed, I want to make that offer.
Okay.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
That's fine.
Is that too long?
Do we want to give a recommendation as a board as far as what we suggest people do for the vote or not? I mean, we're within our rights to do that.
Are the absentee ballots, are there going to be absentee ballots available for that?
Yes.
What date?
Probably not till the 18th. Depends on when we get them.
The 18th.
I don't know if we wanted to give a recommendation on which, what we want rural residents to vote on or not, but. I'm not hearing a lot of support for that.
I don't think it's our job to take a position on it, I guess, but we put it out there.
As a board or as individuals?
I think both.
An individual position that I'd share with anybody.
Oh, yeah.
As far as, from a board perspective, I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, we're within our rights to pass a resolution of saying what our recommendation is. I don't know if there's any willingness to do that or not. I just thought I'd check.
Well, if you want it on the agenda next time, we can discuss it. Anybody else? Motion adjourned.
Support.
All in favor?
Aye.